Welcome. I'm happy to see so many of you, even though we're starting early today. But I hope you had some coffee, and otherwise you can have coffee over there. My name is Anne Mølvang, and I work here at DTU. I'm an alumni relations officer, and I would like to welcome you to this alumni morning meeting. I'm very pleased to be able to welcome you as well. And these two I'm referring to is Robert Mikkelsen, and you are a senior researcher, and also you, Mac, a senior scientist, and they're both working within the Institute DTU Wind Energy. I hope you all agree with the topic today, because we're gonna talk about wind. And within the next 60 minutes, you're gonna learn a lot about the wind car, the DTU wind car. And Robert and Mac has also told me that they will be telling us a bit more about the other research areas they will are looking into at DTU Wind Energy. I would like to encourage you to play along in this within these 60 minutes. So please ask questions. And I understood that you're welcome to ask these questions as we move along. So just raise your hands and ask questions, or maybe you just have a comment to add to the dialogue. We will finish in 1 hour, so you can get on what you want to with the things you want to get on with. And I hope you will help me and my sweet colleague Ulla to clear the plates and just move them on the wagon, and then have a nice day. And now, welcome, Mac, Robert. Pleased to see you.
Thank you, Anne.
Thank you. So, can you hear me? Maybe you can hear me anyway. So, we're going to be talking about the stuff we see here at the entrance. And actually, we should have been one more, but the last guy who is involved in the small wind turbine contest, he is at a conference in the United States right now, so he couldn't be here. It's a song. So we will be trying to do it without him. So the main part of today will be probably on the wind car. And that was the thing at the entrance here. This is a project we've been doing for quite a number of years, since 2008. And I'll be going over the car and some recent results and stuff. So the title of this first part of the talk is Faster Than the Wind, Into the Wind, Powered by Wind. And you will see why this is. So the contents is, so this project is one of the projects we have on wind energy for students. And more specifically, it's like a hands-on course where they actually get to build stuff and do stuff and make a lot of mistakes and learn from some of them. And of course we're able to do this because we go to the Racing Alice contest. Does it work? It doesn't work. Okay. And I'll be talking about, there has been some, within the contest there have been some challenges, and I will be talking about that. And then I'll be showing a little bit of history of this kind of vehicles, and also how this thing works, very hand-waving and in a short fashion. And then I'll be talking about some of the challenges the students and we face when building a car like this. And then I'll be showing things from the race in Holland. That's where most of the races have been, in Den Helder, which is north of Holland, on the dikes. This is actually a picture from us on the dike, and having a good time, being happy. So, wind energy for students, hands-on stuff. The wind car, that's over there. And then there's a small wind turbine competition, where it's all about making, designing a small wind turbine and battling against other teams from, I think only from Europe, right? From universities. The wind car contest is actually from all over the world, cars. There's there's been talk of participation from India for some years, but so far it's been the only non-European contestant has been from Canada. So, but the first part of this talk here is on the wind turbine racer, and it's the contest for the headwind powered cars. And these courses are both wind energy courses under the CDIO idea: conceive, design, implement, operate. So you get to get the idea, design whatever is needed to carry out this thing in the world, implement, make it, and operate and actually drive it. So that's our course. So the boundary conditions for this wind car thing is basically the rule set, and they are here. So you have a box in which you have to fit the car in. So it cannot be, it's not more wide than 2 meters, not higher than 3.4, not longer than 4 meters. And you are racing pretty much straight into the wind. But winds do change, but they try to put the racetrack as far as they can straight into the wind. So that's the idea, building a car that is powered by wind and you go directly into the wind. You can have any turbine type you want, as long as the projected area of it is smaller than 4 square meters. So we have a turbine, four-bladed turbine, that is like the horizontal axis, the normal type, but you could have the other type also, like a Darieux type or stuff like that. And you can have any transmission you like. If you use a battery in between the rotor and the rear wheels, you should be able to show that it's empty when you start the race. So you cannot charge it and then just run for a short while. Charge it for an hour and then run for 2 minutes. Also, there should be a safety grid around the rotor, as you see on our car also. And we need brakes and automatic overspeed protection. If the rotor speeds up and there's a high wind, it can actually speed up very fast. So we need something to be able to prevent it from speeding so much up that the wings fall off. And then we need an emergency exit, which is just the way you get into it, and a horn. So, and how the race really works is that the racetrack is not wide enough for all cars that participate to start at once. So when you do the math on these types of cars, you see that the quantity that determines how fast, how efficient the car is really the ratio of how fast does the car move relative to how much wind we have. So the cars are sent one after each other on the dike, and they measure the wind at 3 points or 2 points along the 500 meters racetrack, and then they time it. And then they can do the average car speed over wind speed. So this is a direct measure of goodness of these kind of cars. So this is what we battle. We battle to get the highest wind or velocity ratio. And all about this safety stuff, is that really necessary? I mean, if for the low wind days the car moves very, very slow, is it really necessary? And I'd like to just show you a funny video, or maybe not so funny. Let's see if I can see. So this is footage of a race start in a couple of years ago. Now you see something is missing on the car. It will be shown here in slower speed. And there it goes off. And so if we didn't have, imagine that we didn't have this ring around it and didn't have a safety grid off it, and there was someone standing by the side and the wing came off, that would be I think that would be the end of these races, actually. So safety is really important, and actually due to this incident, we are now having the overspeed protection rules. So safety is something that we laughed at in the beginning, but actually it turned out to be, we do need it. So that's about safety. And then I'll be talking about some of the challenges that have been embedded in the race. This guy is a German inventor, professor from Fachhochschule in Flensburg, Gustav Winkler, not the singer. He claims to have built the first wind car in 1992. So, and it does work, and I think he was the first to make that, not just having the idea, but actually building it. So he built it in 92, and it's extremely slow, really, really slow. This guy holding it back is not really needed. It was probably for a newspaper or something. And but this guy was he made a theory in 2008 stating that it was impossible for wind cars to go. It's like physically impossible for wind cars to go faster than 50% of the wind speed. So if we have 10 meters per second wind, the car would never be able to move more than 5 meters per second. And of course, we at DTU disagreed quite a lot. You'll see our results a little bit later, computationally also. He was father of that theory, and that's why he thought it was a good idea to say to his university that they should sponsor a 1,000 euro prize for the cars that could pass this impossible limit, because he was sure that that was not possible. And what happened then in 2008 during the first race is that this yellow car and our car and the Stuttgart car, that's the ECN car, we all passed the 50% barrier. So there was clearly something wrong in his theory. So we split these money, the prize money. And what then happened is that the guy in the yellow car here from ECN, that would be the Netherlands version of RISU, like an energy research facility. They announced a 1,000 euro prize award to the first team driving faster than 100% of the wind. So 10 meters per second wind, so the car needs to be moving 10 meters per second or more. And that was set out in 2008, and that is quite much harder than doing 50%. So that's the something we've been aiming towards all the years since 2008, and we've been part of the races ever since 2008. So I think we're the team we're the veteran guys, our team. So, as a part of this prize is this medal for driving faster than the wind, and there's stuff that is not easily understood if you don't speak Latin, but this should be something like nothing is impossible to the valiant. So this is what we've been wanting for since 2008. So that's about these challenges. So history, onto the history going back again. So even though that Gustav Winkler might have been the first one who built an actually functioning car that can go against the wind, powered by wind, the idea is not new. This is drawings from 1335, of course, to move war machinery back and forth. There's been a lot of patents on it, also very old patents, also stuff with a very small rotors on, and probably dubious mechanical efficiency also, and also ideas for doing it on boats, and it turns out you can actually also do it on a boat. As long as you have two things moving relative to each other, you can actually use that to move yourself relative to either of these two media. So you can do it on a boat. So how does it work, and also a little bit about the mechanics here. So this is something I stole from Ingenieuren, who made a nice article about us. And what we have here is that the engine is up here. This is what generates the power from the air. And then we have a shaft where you put it down and put it out on the rear wheel. And we have big wheels. We have a diffuser around the rotor. And this is actually not only because we're into safety and because we have to have something around the rotor to save people if blades fall off. This is actually used to our advantage because you can use something like this to actually boost the performance of this thing. You can lure wind into this rather than going outside by having this. So we're actually putting a great deal of energy and thought into designing a rotor and a shroud or a diffuser that will actually speak together in the right way. The hub in here is more the mechanical part of things, how to control the loading on the rotor disc from these blades, and there's a pitchable blades and everything on it. So these are the parts, and so this is the internals of it. There's the diffuser, the rotor, and then essentially the transmission in this car, and the fastest of the cars have mechanical transmission. Yes?
Question, the restriction on area, no, it's not necessary.
We'll tape it.
Now you're famous.
Restriction on the area, is that to the wingtip or the diffuser area?
It's actually it's to the rotor. So
to
if you take
the
a
tip of the blades.
Yeah.
Okay.
So they cover an area and that area. Yeah.
But the diffuser helps.
Yeah, it does help. Yeah, but we cannot have it wider than 2 meters.
Okay.
Because that's the competition box. And if we want a circular, then I mean we can have two rotors if we want, but it's also getting just building one rotor and diffuser is a big deal. Anyway, so the transmission goes like this. There's an axle, there's a bevel gear, there's another bevel gear, and then there's a chain, and that's it. And then there's a clutch, so we can clutch out and spin the rotor up. And this year's car, we've had many different versions of it, but this year's car, or last year's, last year's car is such that we cannot gear during the race, so we have one gear and then we go for that. And this is simply to keep it simple, because every time you add complexity, you add losses very, very often. It's hard to make a gear system that is as low friction as this. So this is how it works. And about how the energy conversion process works, then when you,
I should like to ask you: is the direction of the rotor, is that fixed, or will it adjust to the wind? Because if you're only running against the wind always, it's no problem. But in real life, you may have a side wind or even wind from behind.
Yeah. So the thing with the wind is that, of course, the wind always moves around. But so just to answer very short your first question, so we can yaw the tower, but not actively. Actually, it's no big deal to do it, but we're going for a lowest hanging fruits concept when trying to optimize the speed of it. So we can yaw the tower, but not during the race, it's between races. So it's like, okay, the car will go this way, the wind comes from there, and then there's the speed of the car also, so then we put it like how we think it is. And then we run on the side or ride a bike or something, and then we have tufts on the diffuser, and we can see if it starts stalling, we can see the tufts not pointing backwards, but they start doing all kinds of stuff. And that's a sign of something not good.
I can maybe add that this car is not supposed to be something that we will have on the streets. So it's only made for this competition and to introduce the wind energy. So we will not see them on the highways.
Yeah, of course, if you were to use it for something more, you would need all these fancy things. But for now, it's very bare bones. I mean, we can go and open it later and you can see how few parts there are in it, really. And that was actually also a development from something more fancy actually towards something simpler, because that actually gives us speed. But the mechanics of how stuff works, or conceptually, if you are the car and then you're going now, this is a situation where you're going against the wind. There's a wind velocity vector and a car velocity. So the car moves this fast. So this fast. And this part here is how much the wind is blowing. So when you sit in the car, you see the road that comes towards you with a speed, and the wind comes towards you with a higher speed. So if you have 10 meters per second and your car moves 5 meters per second, then you see 15 meters per second wind and 5 meters per second road, like this. And then it's just very basically, without going into aerodynamics or anything, the ideal way of converting a force into a power is a power will be a velocity times a force. And what you have on the car is that at top speed of the car, these forces should balance. So the forces the car is subjected to from the road is this big, and that should be balanced by the force that the car is subjected to from the wind. So these two are equally big, this force and that force at top speed. And then you see that since the velocity of the relative wind is bigger than the relative velocity of the road, then you can actually gain more power in the air than you have to spend at the road. And this is really what makes this possible. And you can confuse yourself with a lot of aerodynamic stuff and things, but this is really the ideal. Ideally, if all the force that you spend in the wind is spent making power the ideal way, then this is the power you can get. And if all the force that you transfer to the road is, if you have the ideal case here, you also, this is the ideal thing. And in this case, you see then, okay, this is bigger than that, and these are equally big. Therefore, you can ideally generate more than you spend. And of course, at the top speed you get when these balance. And in reality, you don't have the ideal thing. So. But still, this extra surplus of power is spent on, you're wasting it to friction and non-ideal stuff. So this is really why it works, in very crude terms. And you can look at it differently, split up the forces and say, okay, this is relative wind, this is road, thrust on the rotor, drag on the car, rolling resistance. And then this is you pushing yourself forward with this, and these should balance like that. And this is what we torment students with and making computer programs to simulate stuff, but this is really what it is. Forces in top speed should balance. And then there's something about velocity, and then you can, okay, power coefficients for the rotor and thrust coefficients for the rotor, you can put everything in. But at the end of the day, it's really this energy balance from before. So what you spend, what you get out on the axle, here it's included. This is what you gain. This is what you produce on the rotor, including a little bit of losses there. And then you lose something in transmission. This is what you have on the rear axle to use. And that should balance out with the speed of the car relative to the road. And then you should move the forces you move forward. It's thrust, car drag, drag on the shroud, and rolling resistance. So this is just a simple energy balance, and then you can get the speed of the car. And of course, we go, yes?
When you are estimating the forces, do you take into account that you will probably, I guess, if there's a wind so you can drive, it will be a turbular flow, it will not be laminar. But you will have a boundary layer at the road, and the shape of the car will force some wind to the rotor, and some suctions below the car. Both things will help you, but have you taken that into account, or just
not really.
It entered in the competition?
No, not really. We're kind of, what they're doing in the competition is that they measure actually the wind speed at a height that is pretty much rotor center. So we are saying that there's probably a little bit more wind at this tip, very tip, up tip of the rotor, and there's less below it. And on the car, there's even less because there's like this wind profile that is zero exactly at ground. Yeah. So we don't take that into account. No, but still, there's a variation. But we don't, it's not included in the analysis, really. So actually the drag penalty is for the car, which is actually situated low, we're being quite pessimistic on that, because we're assuming that is being hit by the same velocity as the rotor, which is not, it's not. But still there's much more uncertainty in all this than anybody thinks, even though that we've been working on it for many years. And actually, some of the stuff that we are kind of experts on are aerodynamics, so that's where we spend a lot of effort. So actually, how we optimize the rotor is the interplay between, so this is a cut through in the middle of the rotor, and you can't see the rotor because the rotor is simply a force disk here. These are CFD computations. And this is our optimization of really the good stuff that is directly associated with the rotor. So how much total propulsive force can we get out? So how much are we pushing ourselves forward from the power generated here? And then also there's a force penalty on the rotor and everything. So this is the nitty-gritty details that we're doing during optimization. And I think pretty much we're one of the teams that goes most into detail of this. So these are the coefficients we're trying to optimize. And for instance here, we're seeing how we want to maximize this propulsive coefficient. And then based on how we load the rotor and how big the chord length of the shroud is, we can find an optimum. And then we also need to put some realism into it. We shouldn't go too close to the limit, because then all of a sudden the wind changes and then we have stall on one side of the shroud. So there's also a lot of engineering stuff in here. But this is nasty details. One thing that actually got me and us into thinking that this is a really funny thing to be doing, like a geeky funny thing, is that if you do a very general solution of what will be the top speed of the car given a total efficiency of the car. This is a little bit a vague term, but then you can actually end up with this expression. And this over there, this is the speed of the car divided by the speed of the wind. And you can see when you plot this, this scale goes to 2.8. So this is 20% loss, total loss. So 100% is out here. And this curve goes, actually, let me push a button. Oh, yeah, let me push some more buttons. This curve goes to infinity. So the speed velocity, the velocity ratio of the car actually tends to infinity when the losses tend to zero. And that's a very not so intuitive thing, but this is actually what comes out of the analysis. And then how do you this total efficiency is determine something, what happens in the medium where you generate the power, what happens in the transmission, what happens in the medium where you push yourself forward, the propulsive medium, and then you can define these like this, and in the ideal case these 10-1, all of them, but in reality they're quite far from one, because the first year we were around 50%. So, I mean, there's room for improvement still. And still, so this is also why we did not agree with this German professor that came up with his theory, because we had a much higher maximum velocity than the 50% he claimed. And luckily, we beat 50% also. Anyway, I think we will go to Robert talking about more of the design stuff.
Okay.
Yeah.
You have four blades in your turbine. Is that an optimal solution, or is it a practical solution, or both?
I don't know. Actually, that's one of the really nasty, tricky questions, because one of the things that we are most unsure of is when you design a real turbine without a diffuser around it, there's something called tip losses. And the tip losses, you get less of those if you have more blades. Also, when you have more blades, the Reynolds number goes down, and that's not a good thing, so there's an optimum there. But then you put a diffuser around it. And ideally, that should remove some of the tip losses, but how much, I don't know. The analysis we use for designing this thing is an axisymmetric thing. So with actually no tips, like it's like a disk of forces. So there's actually, this is very, very high, and I don't think anybody doing these races can explain it.
I mean, if we, for instance, look at the curve before going to infinity, and then look at the trend for the thrust force, it actually goes to zero. So in the limit, the you should have zero thrust, so you are moving like in an invincible manner through the air. And that would lead to that you should have a lightly loaded rotor, which is different from power-producing rotor, an ordinary wind turbine. There you would have a high CT value and a low thrust rotor would tend to be designed with many blades and high torque, low tip speed ratio. So that kind of what comes out of the equations as far as our analysis has been.
Yeah, I certainly agree that if you just put like 100 blades, then you'll just have a disc and it'll just you won't get any movement on it. It'll just be, the wind will just blow you backwards. But have you tried just removing one, or like a three-bladed one, or just done the experiments?
We have tried two-bladed, using two-bladed. So that's, with the pitch hub we have, we can just easily remove two of the blades and then also run. But as I, my experience is that you should have many blades, low tip speed ratio, a high torque rotor, and not a high thrust rotor. And that's looking at, for instance, the Canadian car that exploded. I kind of disagree with their design because they have an extremely fast spinning rotor. And it requires a lot of gearing. So if you have a low speed turning rotor, you can have gearing ratios that are, you could say, closer to one. So going a bit to some of the practical stuff, what the students, they do. So there are many different things the students, they can choose to work with. We have had one team of students trying to go into the details of the aerodynamics of the actually monocoque, and here we are have a model which is fitted with pressure tabs, and they have looked at different angles. They have tried to look at where we have the speed up effects and see if they could reduce the aerodynamics of the monocoque. So this is a wind tunnel testing in very small scale, but we measure the detailed pressure field on this turbine. Building, it's a combination of fiber work. So this is the bottom part where we have a combination of fiber and foam layers, and there's some hard points. Here's some metal pieces that we place strategically so we can attach the rotor or the tower. And this is the transmission that we have right now, the upper transmission with a pitch hub, and so it's an oil lubricated gearbox. The shaft goes through the pitch mechanism. There's a pitch rod going around the shaft. And then it goes through the tower, it connects to the clutch, and then out here where we can attach a sprocket. We also had a very fancy bicycle gear from a pinion, which has like 18 gears, and that allowed us to make runs in very low wind speed. But it's not efficient if we go into high winds, and there we bypass this one and put the sprocket on directly here, and then connect it to the rear wheel axle. And this is kind of the most popular design among, you could say, all teams. Bevel gear, some shaft through tower, some more gearing and a chain, and then it's been combined in different ways with a gearbox. But the overall design is like this for most of the teams. We have been
excuse
to
me,
Velux.
Question.
A question?
The gearbox, you designed it also yourselves, or you supplied?
Yeah, we bought the raw gears, and we built, manufactured all this, and designed it, and computed on the moments and the power throughput that we could handle. So our target is in the order of 5 to 8 kilowatts. Should we be able to have as a power throughput, and the transmission should be able to handle forces like that.
Do you use deep groove ball bearings?
Which
for the gears?
We use ordinary ball bearings.
Yeah.
We also done some full scale tunnel testing. This is at Velux. Where we measured the performance. We had a braking system here where we could add a braking torque to the wheel. So we measured torques at the rear wheel axle and also at the pitch up, so we could measure the efficiency of the system. We also measured, we see here some pressure taps or tubing. So we had some pressure measurements on the shroud, and also we tried to measure the wake profile behind the rotor. This was a lot of fun, and that's in the Velux tunnel, which is the largest in Denmark. It has 4x4 square meters of test area, so it's an open jet. So looking at racing aeros over the many years. We have here the best photo of the first event where we were driving in front of the Stuttgart team, and unfortunately we actually lost that race. But I was in the lead all the way until the last 50 meters. And we have seen, you know, many, many different designs. We have also seen one vertical combined with a very complicated electric transmission, and that did unfortunately not work. We also had the event twice in Denmark at Stauning Airport, where we have the Danish Flight Museum, and we organized that, and there the team from Amsterdam, they actually came out as winner. That was an event characterized by very low winds. So Stauning is in the western part of Denmark, and it was autumn and no wind. So we were very unlucky.
For 2 years.
For 2 years. So, what did I do? Some of the different vehicles. So there has been a large variation in types of designs. So this is the Stuttgart vehicle. They had a very fancy kind of carbon frame. In the first years, it was popular to have some extremely large shrouds, and we're quite sure that he made some calculation errors here. His InVisit code must have kind of found a special optimal point. But so this one is, the length of this is like 130 centimeters or so. It could drive, but fairly slowly. This is the team from Kiel, and that's the only other team that has also participated every time. So DTU and Kiel has participated at all the events. Yeah, so he's controlling the yawing manually. And it's again, it's a three-bladed rotor with a gear and a extremely heavy gearbox. I think 200 kilos or something like that, with some advanced pneumatic system for shifting gears. And we had Austria. I think they only participated once. And here the we say they have to pay additionally with a design like that, with a lot of grid around it, as the safety requirements, they are they enforce that we should have the grid. And as I recall, this one mostly went backwards. is that true?
It did.
Yeah.
It went pretty fast backwards.
But this is a way to get closer to the 4 square meter, rather than ours, which only has like slightly above 2. So here you can get 4 square meters of rotor area. Emden Lier, also a design very similar to in transmissions as ours. And here, Istanbul, there has been several Turkish teams trying to participate, and they have typically been able to run at the last day of the event. That's our experience. So we have often helped them, or all other teams have tried to assist in making sure that they could run with their car. So the Delft team, they have also a very nice carbon monocoque. And then the Amsterdam team, they had this very nice thing from a sailplane. They built it around. And this is actually it was a commercial wind turbine. This is a donkey. They sold in the order of 1,000 of these, and I think then they went bankrupt. But this turbine you may see around somewhere as like a house turbine. The Canadian team, the team coming from the furthest distance away, very skilled. Their students often have a background as a what do you call it, a Handwerker background. So they actually know to build stuff themselves, and they have by far made the most nice car, you know, very nice details, and a lot of electronics that also work, and they have won the event twice. So I think we see them as our strongest competitor. But they did not perform so well this year. Then there has been a number of twin rotor designs. Bristol made this twin rotor design, and they also combined it with electric transmission. And they were able to drive, but fairly slowly. We have not seen them the last years. Another twin rotor design. There was one event where we had very low winds, and this is a private guy who actually built this by himself. He was a plumber, I think, actually, and he built this, and he actually ended up winning the entire event that year.
A plumber beat all the universities.
Yeah. What about the driver? It seems to be full grown persons.
Yeah, you have to be above 18, and there's also it's a 75 kilo.
So it must be a hard diet before driving.
yeah. So. No, you have to be grown up. So there are some insurance policies and stuff like that we have to follow. But this guy, he actually won, and it's the. He uses a chain mechanism, so there's not a shaft. It's a chain mechanism here, and then a long shaft that goes through the whole car, and then a small bevel gear here at the rear, and then out to the wheels. Then we have this keel. They have been coming with the same car for like 8 years with no changes. But then this year they actually made this new vehicle, which is a three-wheeler with a rotor in front. And they are connected to the same shaft with some gearing. Unfortunately, it actually did not go at the event. So they had some mechanical problems. We hope to see it next year. Stuttgart, who won the first year, are also very skilled, making some very nice carbon work. They have always preferred two-bladed, and they have here a variant where the small front rotor is actually electric, and they have tried this twice now, and it does not work for them yet. So the rear rotor is working mechanically with some shaft and gearing. And then all the DTU cars over the years. The first up here. So this is one morning, like 6 o'clock or something like that, where we had been working all night, and we had to go to Holland just after that. We have tried different things. This was a belt transmission. This one was also a belt transmission, a belt going into the tower here, and then twisting in the tower in order to get the rear wheel shaft and the rotor shaft aligned. And that was in Stauning. And then we, with this car, we bought a Harley Davidson gearbox. Now we were kind of the other teams, they beat it, and we wanted to have a very strong gearbox. So we bought a Harley Davidson gearbox and a clutch, and then we set a new record, going 75% with this vehicle, and that actually stood for some years, this record. And then the additional teams. We have actually two cars. We have, as the only team, I would say, been able to run successfully with electric transmission. So this one is electric. We bought some off-the-shelf synchronous servo motors, 5 kilowatts. And then we connected it here with some gearing and also at the bottom. And that actually worked, connected them directly without any control, just three phases stiffly connected. And if we are rotating here, we actually see a similar rotation at the rear wheel axle. We are now in the process of modifying this one up there, where we try to include some electrical gearing in that version up there. And we hope to have that running this year. Okay.
I think I should push a button or something.
I will show a few movies.
So how does it look? This is how it looks when we run. This is, of course, a run where we look really good. We were racing against I can't remember who, but that's the other car. We just passed it. And there's a bicyclist, and there's quite a hard wind. So he's doing what he can. And now you can see the speed of the car once it gets closer. So it's actually, it was pretty fast.
So that's roughly like 30 kilometers or so.
Yeah, and in a short while, you'll see the bike coming now and struggling still.
So, he's
so it was really fun to drive the car and look out at the bicyclist. So this is how it looks when everything works after 8 years and waiting for really high winds. So this is how cool it can look. And then there's also a part of the competition as like an extra competition where we do some drag racing. This is actually after the drag races are over, but we're drag racing against a car with a gearbox. So they start really fast, and this is us. And I had to brake because there are some metal bars here, and they only fits one car. But on the other side, after the movie ended, I passed him, of course.
And that's me, Chewie.
So, how did we do? So this is the latest race results, and then there are some dots of different colors. The blue dots are DTU results. That are our results. So if you see, there's mostly blue here. So what we see on the axis, this is wind speed measured like a mast measuring wind speed. So this is mean wind speed during the race of the car. So you can see that the speed, the lowest speeds where cars were running was 3 meters per second, and then it got up to more than 10 meters per second. But the good thing here is that our dots, the blue dots, are high, and they're kind of highest in all these wind velocities, between 5 and, yeah, well, all the way up. So that was a good thing. So we actually did well. And what you have on the other graph here, I forgot to say, this is how many percent we go, how many percent of the wind speed we go. So the 100% speed is here. And we have exactly one dot here, which we are really proud of. That's where everything just worked. And in another way of plotting it, it's like this is wind speed and that's car speed. And then the blue line there is 100% line. And as you see it, when you see it like that, you can see that we did really well here. In fact, above 100%. So that's a new world record. We were really happy. And we also overall won the event because we did kind of best in everything except very low velocities. Actually, our car cannot really run under this velocity. Then it just doesn't move. And these guys were, of course, very angry, the guys with these dots, because they said that it should supposed to run. And these are actually... That was all the data from one of the race days. But then it was decided that overall we were the winner. So, of course, we were happy and they were not so happy. But why did we do so well? I think going there and looking at the other cars, why did we do well? I think we do well because we have like this lowest hanging fruits, sensible approach. How can we make gain a little bit of speed the smartest, the simplest way, not making a fancy solution where the car can play a tune and the blades go there and flashes go on and off. This is just, we're having a very, very simple car. So I think that is one of the key things. We keep it simple and like not fall in love with the complex solutions. So, again, simple. Lowest hanging fruits design, simple design. And we're good at aerodynamics. And after all, this is our engine. So this corresponds to Formula One teams, where the team that has the strongest engine that is durable will have a very, very big advantage. So this is, our engine is really good. And... yeah, well, this is a slide I made, so So we have him, and I can do math, I can do computers, I can do stuff, but he can also, apart from that, actually make stuff work. And this is actually a secret ingredient. I mean, we can show all the nice graphs we want, but stuff has to work, and there's like, it's a log chain of stuff, and if one of these things break, then it doesn't work. And he's actually the what is that called? You guarantee that nothing is impossible. So, what happens from here? We got this 100%. We beat that record, and we got we will get the prize and the money and all that. So we thought that we've been hunting this for 8 years. What now? So the minute we got it, we said, okay, we will now sponsor another award, which is 125%, that we will take up also maybe next or year or something. So this is something to strive for, 125%. And also getting an electric transmission car to battle and actually be a real threat to the mechanical cars. Because so far, the electric cars has been failing really bad. Also, all cars with a vertical axis wind turbine, it's not really so easy. It's a bigger area, but it's really tricky to make it work. So that would be fun to have the first car to do that. Maybe even turn it around so it's like a my tasker or something. That would be a fun version of that. And also measure more stuff, analyze stuff, because there's still a lot of open questions. This about tip correction. Would it be a better idea with two bigger blades, or there's a lot of open things. So if we can measure stuff more accurately so we can believe it, then we will learn more. This is on the to-do list. So that was, I think, all we had to say about the car. And now we have 5 minutes left or something, and Robert will talk a little bit about the other devices you see up there.
Det er den mølle, der står der. Ja, den står herovre. Yeah, so this is the other activity, hands-on wind energy, we have with students. We go to also Holland, we go to Delft universities. They have a fairly large wind tunnel, an open jet, and here we have the team from last year. We had two turbines, a vertical axis and a horizontal axis, and we have built all the parts here. This one you can see over here. It actually has a pitchable system on it, some cyclic pitching. This one we tried some passive pitching system. There are some masses here. It's a classical design, trying to have something working in a passive manner. So the spirit of the is to make a turbine that could actually work as a small turbine to be put out on the in the open and operate more or less like itself.
This works.
And this is the there are some boundaries. We need to have some safety. The turbine has an area of max 2 square meters. And then we go to Delft. And then I'll try to show this small movie here. This is from the testing. We see the cob anemometer working. This is a DC generator. So this type of turbine has problems with a startup, and we use a battery to accelerate it a bit. And then at some point when the speed is high enough, we switch the electric system, so we're actually charging. And this is kind of the speed we have, running up to like 400 RPM. Uh, Yeah, so the students have built all the blades, all the mechanical components. Of course, we bought the generator, but otherwise many of the parts are custom made by the students. And it's a lot of fun going there. I'll shortly mention some other model scale wind turbine work that we do. We have had some research project on floating turbines. Whether that's the future or not is I think, a bit undecided. There are a number of full-scale floating wind turbines around, but they are, I would say, only single test turbines. So it's not a turbine you can find on the market yet. So there's a number of open questions related to finding the right type of floater, which is cheap enough for this system to be affordable. And we have investigated here a tri-floater semi-submersible type, and here a tension leg platform type. I'll show a small movie of that. So these measurements are made at DHI, and we have a wind field on the rotor. So the challenge here is that we have to scale it according to the float number, and aerodynamically that's kind of bad because we get very low velocities and Reynolds numbers become very small, so it's difficult to make the rotor work. We have Reynolds numbers that are in the order of 20 to 50,000, and that's for aerodynamics, that's not very good. So we have wind speeds up to like 2 meters per second. But we have a fully coupled system here. This is the TLP, and what you saw here was a focused wave. And we have carried out some long campaigns on this. The turbine has a variable speed and a variable pitch on the two generators and the pitch system. Okay, I think that more or less concludes our presentation about model scale wind turbine work and student activities and a bit on our research with floating wind turbines.
Thank you to the both of you. I'm happy that you came here today.
Thank you.
And now I hope you've had all the questions answered that you wanted to. You had the chance. And if you please help us clean up and bring your plate, bring your cup and place it on the table over there. And then have a nice weekend.
There's a question there.
Oh, we have a question.
When is the next Stauning competition planned?
I'm not sure we dare to go there. I had thought of the idea of perhaps doing it at Værløse Airport. I mean, if it could be organized there, then it would be. And we go there with our students and test drive. But whether an event like this could be there, I'm not sure.
Are you changing the configuration in your car depending on expected wind speed on the race, like pitch on plates, gearing ratio, and many other parameters maybe?
I mean, we have different sprockets that we can. So we can change the last part of the transmission. So we can set different sprockets on. And then we can adjust according to the wind speed.
And in fact, we have many sets of blades also. So if there's a low wind speed, what changes in low speed is that the relation between, so all aerodynamic forces scale the same way. But the thing that doesn't scale is probably there's something with losses in the transmission, that there's something more constant, at least a part of it, and then also rolling resistance. So when the wind speed is low, there's a relatively bigger amount of losses, and then the car goes slower, and then the optimum is a different place. So then we actually need blades with more torque, so more chord length. So we have blades actually designed for a wind turbine that fit on. So for really low winds, we put on bigger blades also, in addition to gearing.